Good night.
Good night, everybody.
We on African time tonight. On African goddess time. You know what I'm saying?
Caribbean, all of that.
African goddess time. You see it. But now is the time, the right time. You're tuned in to the sanctuary. With O2 Sensual Sanctuary. I'm the Connie, the Black Orchid.
Amber Honey.
Right on. And we are O2 Sensual Sanctuary. Welcome to our sanctuary live. Give thanks for tuning in, everyone. What's happening, Africa with Toto? I see you. Right on. So tonight we are going to be discussing our book club that we started, the Kunyaza book by Habeeb Akande. And we were going to be talking about the first chapters up to page 36, where it started chapter 4, right? 66, exactly. Exactly, it is 66. That was a test. We got our little churai burning, you know what I'm saying? We got our little spirits going. This is some rose-infused Appleton Preserve rum from Jamaica. That's how we turning up a little bit, you know what I'm saying? A little cap, for the combo, right? Mm-hmm. Well, anyway, this book, let me take a seat. We have some chai tea here to wet our whistles. Let me get in my seat properly, right? So, the Kunyaza book by Habeeb Akande, The Secret to Female Pleasures. Okay, people, let me just tell you. As I opened up the book, the introductions
alone
just had me just like, oh my gosh. You know, the introduction alone, I thought it was like the first chapter. I'm not going to lie. It was so interesting. It was like drawing me in to like all the things that I love about being a woman and being sensual and knowing my sexuality.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I'm just like, it's a normal thing. Yeah. But when you're living out here in the West, mm-hmm. it's like, it's something for taboo, it's something forbidden. No, we're supposed to be pleasured. We are pleasurable human beings, especially us women. And these are things that are discussed inside this book that we may already know about and didn't know that there was a word for it.
Right.
Or if we may or may not have known about it and now we do and we want to know more, we want to share with our partner to enhance your experiences, your intimate pleasures, or what have you. There's some real cool, interesting stuff in this book. So let's dig in. So, Brother Habeeb Akande, and that's one thing I can say, you know, it's a man writing to women about women's things.
Right.
And he's right. Pretty on point with his research.
Exactly.
I'm really loving it. I can't wait to get deeper into the book. But thus far, some of the points that I've jotted down inside of the book club, and so my notes, because I got to write notes and stuff, right? So it's coming from a traditional African sexual and sensual practices, right? This is like before, like Kama Sutra. Maybe we only know about Kama Sutra. We ain't hear about Kunyaza. I've never heard about it until I saw it on Instagram a few weeks ago, ever, right? But I'm sure there had to have been something before Kama Sutra, because right. We're the first peoples, right? So these people out here in Rwanda and Eastern African regions, the women in the villages are taught from their like in puberty about these kinds of practices. It's not something that is forbidden to talk about. It's not something like when you have your period in the West, oh, you're about to have bad luck and it's a curse and all of these kinds of things. These things are embraced. It wasn't so much about having your cycle, but what they were saying is that it starts from like when you have like rites of passages, you go to like your aunties and they called it, there's a word for it, starts with an S. Forgive me not having no words, but I'm gonna have my vocabulary and everything ready for next time. But these women are passed, these traditions are passed down orally, just like a jelly, just like an African griot, a keeper of the tradition. So there's women that are keeper of the traditions of these Kunyaza practices and these modern African...
Distinctively on your paternal side. So
yes.
I like that they highlighted that.
Yes.
It's your father's sisters that bring you through that rites of passage.
Yes, yeah. Yes, yes. So, you know, I mean, you're getting passed down from your dad's side of his sisters and their sisters and sisters mm-hmm. and sisters and stuff like right. that, right? And you get it when you're a teenager or so, rites of passage, they take you to the bush. I read that they take you to the bush and they teach you these kinds of things. So some of the things that they're talking about in this book is female ejaculation. Not urination, but it's actually, they call it the water, the sacred water.
Right.
The sacred water is like a spring that if you massage the yoni right, if you massage that pearl tongue right, it's going to come to like the fountain of youth. Right? Oh my goodness. So when I'm reading this book, right, I'm just thinking about how much mattresses and stuff must cost, how much bedding
right.
these people is going through, because this is like a regular thing. This is not something that just happens once in a while. This is like how they get down regularly.
Mm-hmm.
Because yeah. in these traditions, these men are taught that if you cannot pleasure your wife in these kinds of ways, you are not
Something's
worthy.
What's wrong with you? You're not worthy of her.
I'm in the wrong country. Jana, oh my gosh, this is like the greatest book. I said, whoever my partner is in my life
has to read that book.
Has to read this right? book with me, because brother has to gonna know some of these things. And guess what? I know these things. I myself know these things. I practice some of these things myself. Right? And I can say, and I talked to somebody today, one of my friends, and I said, you know what? I've had this water fountain of youth happen to me 2 times in my life. Right? I'm almost 50 years old. I'm telling you guys my age. But 2 times in my life, I've had this running water thing. And it didn't feel like I was urinating on myself. It was something totally, totally different.
Yeah.
These lovers that I had, this one, he was very, very special. He knew some things. You know what I mean? And that's one of the experiences I had with this person.
The one person or two different people?
Two different people.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's this like, it was something about the technique of what they were doing. And they never read the book, but they knew something about the happenings and showed me something. And I was telling my friend today, I said, boy, it happened twice in my life. I said, this right here is gold. Women, we need to be reading this and sharing these with our partners, because these are the kind of things that we can talk about to preserve our marriages.
Yes.
Dee, we're talking about how most women do not climax. Most women do not have orgasms.
I think you said 70% of Western women.
Western. In the Western world.
So 70% of people women in the Western world don't have orgasms.
I believe it. And I'm just like saying, okay, hey, you might have the gallus man. You might have the man with trunk, or blow out your back and everything and blow it out, yes?
Ooh,
but
yes.
Did you come?
Right.
Did you bust? Did you feel this feeling that they're talking about in this book? And I'm saying you probably didn't.
And is he taking the time?
Is he taking the time to make you reach there? It's
exactly.
a whole
different level.
Practice of mm-hmm. foreplay. In this book that is for heterosexual couples, and these couples, these people in these regions of Africa are grown up in this thing. This is like a cultural norm. It's not something that's looked, if you don't do it, it's a problem.
Right.
If you don't do it, you suck. You ain't gonna have no woman. You ain't gonna have no life. Ain't nobody gonna marry
yes.
you. You is worthless if you cannot make this happen.
About the little boy. Did you
yes.
The little boy who was raised, who was taught by the farmers, and he was 16, I think.
Yeah.
When he had first sexual encounter
with a 28-year-old
woman.
Yes.
And he went in there and he thought he was doing something, and she was like, what are you doing? This is how you do it. And he said,
I'm not going to talk about the age differences and all that.
Right.
Or something, but I'm just
right.
saying, this is what they're doing
yeah.
back there in these times, whatever, I don't know. But
and then he said after that he felt like he was a man, like
yeah. He like, she told him that you have to take time and you have to beat the clitoris. Not beat it in like a beat down, I'm a bruise
right.
you, but like you have to like
tap it
and make it come to life. And you have to pull on the labias and all these different
yes.
kinds of something. right? And in this book, they was talking about how you pull on your labias to make them elongated. It's a practice, and this practice also helps the women in these villages, in these countries, achieve some kind of fantabulous orgasm that I've had twice in my life.
I guess it works.
That they have all the time.
You seem very salty.
I am salty, but guess what? I got the techniques now.
So, you know, okay, so me, it happens regularly now.
Okay.
But let me tell you, before I had children,
yeah,
it was just like every once in a while I would orgasm.
Okay.
After going through carrying children and I guess connecting to my womb a little bit deeper.
Uh-huh.
Because even when I have children, I have orgasm births. Like, I orgasm through my actual...
Through the birth?
Through my labor.
Okay. Okay.
So, I guess that was some kind of...
Because it's contracting.
Right.
Yeah.
Some kind of foundation for me. Now, I do orgasm regularly like that, yes.
This is the kind that gets your whole bed sheets wet up.
Yeah.
And they have, like, they say that when they want to court you, when they want to marry you, they come with their woven, like, grass mat thing as a sheet protector. That's like an honor to be able to give your woman a grass sheet protector, because you plan on making her happy every night in the most pleasurable and delicate fashions. Because that's her birthright in her country.
Yes, it is.
Let me just say, in Western country, y'all men is very, very, very single way roaded, you know, just one way. Just
some of them. Let's not
that's
say
true.
All.
That's true. Thank
Let's
you, Shuni. I'm not going to say all.
Some.
Number uno is just don't cares.
Right. As long as they get theirs, that's it.
That's it.
Yeah.
Men are business about... how much you want, feel, and how much more you need, and this and this and that. Them not be deaf on them kind of levels. And those them ones are selfish, but them ones also can sling the cocky.
And I love that they point. They pointed out that a lot of this is
terrible and wicked.
You getting too personal with this.
But I'm saying, it's true. They have a suffering over here. We need to go to Africa, ladies.
A lot of people think that, you know, Islam is strict and, you know, they don't let women do certain things or whatever. But I liked in this book that it's actually, Muslim men actually practice the reverse. And we were taught by the Western world and Christianity that it was a sin, it was an abomination to do certain things. Yeah. And when the white man came to Africa, he didn't like how he did certain things. So he was like, no,
it's evil, it's wrong,
don't do that. And we put negative connotations on our sexuality and what we
especially
do.
For women.
Exactly.
Because at this time, it was
and
all
in the
everything about for us.
Exactly.
Before them time, mm-hmm. before they came. These things was happening.
But again, that goes to the Adam and Eve story. Like, they want to blame the woman for everything.
Yeah.
But still.
No.
I like that they shared that Muslim men are brought up to actually pleasure their wives because that's the showing honor to your wife.
Yes.
And it's only done to your wife.
Yes. It's a sacred thing.
It's a sacred thing that they only do to their wives. So. It's like, it's said in the book, like, if you were a prostitute or if you were, like,
just a one-night stand,
you know.
You're never going to get those kind of action
from
these people that hold that kind of treasure.
From that man. It's just safe for your wife. And I thought that was beautiful. I thought that was a beautiful dedication to a sacred woman that they have in their life.
And they have these practices and these talks amongst their villages from different age groups, right? And they were talking about how the traditions have been changing because of the westernized, the internet and social media and stuff like that. And so there's a lot of pornography that shows a whole nother way of sexual dealings and pleasing women.
Pleasing a woman.
Just doing it.
It's just the woman there to please the man. That's how they just... Yeah, and it's very true. In most Western pornography, the woman is just there to take it and to give oral or to please them.
Yeah.
It's not about us receiving pleasure.
No, and so it's like a confusing kind of like thing. And so the people that are like inside of the villages still that are holding on to the tradition, they're using social media to promote these kinds of practices again amongst the youth. You know what I mean? To keep it safe and instilled inside there.
Right.
And what they've also been saying, just like everything else that these Westerners and these white folks be coming up and taking and thieving from us, is that they are taking these practices and culture and commercializing them. And they're using our practices, like the Kunyaza and these different kinds of practices, for their own material gains. They were talking about these kinds of things in the books, how these Westerners, these women are coming across over there to their... You know, to the villages, and they're staying there for months and years or whatever to get to know it or know the practice.
And they're bringing it back, and they're probably labeling it as something else.
Yes. It's mm-hmm. They're talking about it being on people's, like, porn sites or people's sexual health pages. They're talking about female ejaculation and stuff like that. I'm just like, wow, they're already trying to point it and teeth it, just like everything else.
Right.
So these are our things. And we need to reclaim them and know that they're for us and we don't need their input. And this is what these women are saying when they're having their discussions about female ejaculation, if it's real, if it's not real, and how they don't believe in it. You know, Western society says, no, it's, they try to always defame everything that's glorious about being a woman.
Right.
Bottom line. Right? And so... one of the points that they were talking about in the culture, the way that this whole Kunyaza thing happened, they were talking about the Queen of Rwanda, right?
Oh, I love that story.
Entanglement 101. If this wasn't a damn entanglement, I don't know what it is, right? Ancient history entanglement. Big up the entanglementers. I'm just saying.
Makati, stop promoting strippiness.
I know. But I'm just saying, but it's in the book, right? The book was basically talking about the Queen of Rwanda. Her husband was gone away to war, you know, or was gone away for a certain amount of time, and she was feeling like she needed to be pleasured. So she called her servant, her guard, or whatever, you know what I'm saying? Like, hey, come over here and give me a piece. You know what I'm saying? I need some attention. He's just like scared out of his mind. He's like, no, but she's like demanding. She's like, I'm the queen. And if you don't, you know what I'm saying? Whatever, whatever. So she put this pressure on this man, which was not so very fair. But what he did do, he never penetrated her. This is the story. He never penetrated her, but what he did, he kept on smacking.
I like that. They said he was shaking. So
he was shaking and trembling.
Yeah, he was trembling.
He kept on doing some of this stuff.
Yeah.
And, you know, some of this kind of stuff and flippity-flop and this kind of action on those areas heightened her up to where this kind of thing, this sacred water fountain, sprouted and leaped.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So after feeling so much pleasure that she had never, ever felt before with her husband, when he came back, she says, hey, I want you to do this, and showed him. And I guess that was when, you know, was going to be happening, and this is how it came to pass. And there was another story, I think, that it was
there's a reverse with her without a person. So it's just,
yes,
he went away and she was getting to know her body.
Yes.
And then she was doing the tapping motion and on her yoni and the clitoris and her vulva.
And she was pulling on the labias
and
stuff like
on the
that
labias,
too.
And that's how
she found out of herself. So there's different stories about how the way that Kunyaza came to effect, and that was also pretty interesting. But some of the points that I've, just within the introduction of the book as it relates to the sanctuary, since we're tuned in live to O2 Sensual Sanctuary,
yeah,
and we're all about sensuality and sexuality and African traditional, you know, remedies and, you know, concoctions and sacredness and all of these kinds of things, right? That's what we're promoting here. So page 13, I loved it. It was talking about the Kayan Mata, K-A-Y-A-N-M-A-T-A, herbal aphrodisiacs. Handed down the generations by women for women, traditional sex and beauty practices include Kayan Mata, herbal aphrodisiacs in Nigeria. Dukan, that's woman steaming, yoni steaming,
yoni
right?
Steaming.
in the Sudan, they have jidija, waist beads in West Africa, or bin bin, or jelly jelly grigri, waist beads, right? And then we also have gunkuna, labia pulling, and kunyaza, female ejaculation inducement in Rwanda. So these are all these different things that are accompanying the whole aspect of this sacred African practice of female ejaculation, right, and sexuality practices.
Right.
You know, this is our Kama Sutra. I never heard about Kunyaza, but I did know about Kama Sutra before. So that was in page 13. And they're talking about these herbal aphrodisiacs that the women are either inserting into their vagina, like as an oil.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and most of it, what is very prominent about what they're actually inserting. We use honey for a lot, like mascara.
Yeah.
We use honey for a lot.
Yeah.
And what they insert is honey based.
Yes.
It's a honey based thing that they insert into them to sweeten them and to lubricate them. It says in there.
Yes, it did. It says that the popular honey-based aphrodisiac is to be applied on the vulva or inside the vagina to facilitate lubrication.
Yep.
Hello. And it says other kinds of cayenne mata practices are said to tighten the vagina walls. That's probably like alum, you know, something like one of those kinds of things that's supposed to tighten up the
Right. Combs.
I've heard people using it. I've never tried it, but, you know, do them kegels, everybody. That keep it tight, too. Okay, and this is one of the funny things, because I'm a cook, right? This is really how come I was liking this page. And it was saying, for some, sex without having the use of cayenne mata, the honey, mm-hmm, aphrodisiac, or the one that's going to tighten up yourself, so the one that's going to lubricate, or the one to tighten it, right? For some, sex without cayenne mata is like cooking without salt. It's like cooking without pepper.
So it's needed.
Yes. Right. So that was one of the things that we all, you know, we're all about that here. We're practicing these kinds, mm-hmm, of things in the birth of O2 Sensual Sanctuary.
Yes, we were.
You know, like she said, she's like using her honey scrubs. She's into the waist beads.
Right.
We're both into the lingeries and the bin bins and, you know, just like the whole sensual aspects of African female traditions.
Unlike the Western world, well, it's just like lay down and let's get it in. Like, there's more to it.
Yeah, he's talking about...
It's a whole act. It's like a... I don't know. Like, you have to prepare yourself for your lover.
It's not you can't just run and
exactly
jump up into it. They have no patience. But that's what's wrong with everything. The fast food, the fast this, the instant gratification.
Right.
They want to come... The instant gratification, we mashing up everything.
Mm-hmm.
They don't want to take the time, right? And they were talking about how most of us women here are dissatisfied because these guys feel entitled to be pleasured and, you know, and to be pleased. What kind of nonsense and foolishness is that? We've been catering to that for too long.
That's the Western male chauvinistic,
patriarchal,
you know?
Yeah.
My stroke, my ego.
Yes, that part. This is what they also said. I don't have the exact page, but they were talking about the use of this same kunyaza technique, right? This kunyaza technique, it takes the place of people that do not like or do not wish to practice oral sex. It said it in the book. So for people that have a problem with it or don't like to do it, this is a way that you can still get that kind of foreplay to the woman in those kinds of ways.
Okay, so it replaces.
Yes.
Replaces the...
The kind of action.
Okay.
I guess, you know, I don't think it's supposed to emulate it at all, but it's supposed to just give you that same kind of sensation as if, you know, like the tension that's going down
okay.
that you're giving.
Okay.
If your person is not down there or they're not doing it, you ain't gonna know
what that's like.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So this kind of thing is supposed to give you that kind of sensation if your partner is not the kind that does that thing that we love. Badness, rudeness. Hey, have you guys ever seen that movie Lunatic? she took up the lunatic, and you know what they say about Jamaica man. They're crazy, right? The ones that's crazy in this mind. If you ever see any of the movies, then things is always a printout in them pants, and they're always tall and long up. It's a no joke. There's a movie. I've seen it, and so that's like the thing in the back. The crazy man, the things is always long. So she take up one of the crazy men, and she was reading a book, and she's like, rudeness, nastiness all the time, and she's looking at the guy, man, more nastiness. Watching the man shower, he had to go put it on the pool lady. That's what it happens. The Western culture teaches how to be prudes.
Yeah.
And we are not.
We're not prudes.
We are not prudes. Yeah. There's so many words, everybody. This book, so far, what I've learned inside are some of those things that I've touched on. I talked to you guys about the dysfunctions from the Western culture, from ours. I talked about the Queen of Rwanda. Let me see what other pages I highlighted. Okay, this is some other parts I wanted to talk about. 10 things to get you in the mood, and we'll stop there. So, number one.
Is?
Accept yourself. Do not do anything that compromises your view of yourself as a woman.
Hey.
Facts, facts, facts. Oh, here's my little bells. Remember I said I was going to find something.
Oh, you did.
Well, that's my wind chime, you know what I'm saying? Because we had to chime in for that one. Accept yourself, ladies. And whatever form or fashion, you have to, all your work in progress. All when you're down and out, accept that you're down and out and you're doing better each day. You know what I'm saying? Accept that this is what it is for right now, but that's not what it is forever.
It's not what it's going to be.
Yes, it's temporary. Accept who you are. Accept yourself. That's what number one said. They're all healthy affirmations. Let me see where my page go. I lost my page. Hold on, people. Oh, let me find the page
over here.
Yes, thank you. You see there? Is it here? That's Shuni. She got me. Accept yourself. Page two, part two. Think about pleasure. Set the mood.
Right.
All of these things that we're talking about in the sanctuary, we're talking about the incense burning.
Every sense.
You know what I'm saying? All of the senses. We're all talking about senses. Draping yourself in something nice and sexy. We're talking about eating something that reminds you of being sensual, something chocolatey, something honey.
Heightened.
Yes, heightened, right? So it says, think about the pleasure. The word mood means state of mind. So you have to be prepared, like you were saying. They have to be able to put us in the mood, too, and take time with us. But as well as us, run your bath.
Right.
Do whatever your turn up is.
You know, put some oils on.
That, you know what I'm saying?
Make you smell sweet and put you in a romantic mood. Burn the incense.
Exactly. Yes, stop. Mm-hmm. How about number three? Number three says, to touch yourself. You have to know what you like. It's how like you gonna know what you like if you don't touch yourself?
You can't tell him what to do if you don't know what you want to do with yourself.
Idea. You better know. You better know. Ugandan Senga. That's what the word is. S-S-E-N-G-A. Those are the ones that are do like this. That are the sexual therapists. The ones that are gonna teach you about counseling. The ones that are gonna show you probably about Kunyaza, right? Show you about everything that's healthy in being a sensual woman. These are the sexual counselors in African cultures, right? This is what they're saying. Ugandan singer Betty Lalongo encourages women to explore their own bodies by masturbating to understand what turns them on, which they can then teach to their male partners during kachabali, right? Masturbation helps to promote healthy blood flow to the genitals. Kachabali is when they're talking about the pulling of the labias. Yeah. Yes. That's what they call it in their country. It keeps you connected to your own sexuality and helps you understand how your body likes to be touched, caressed, and pleasured. So, how many women can even say that they do it? I do. I can say it. I do. And I like it because I know what I like. And that just as they said it, I know what I like and I know what I can tell the person if they don't know what I like.
Right.
So if you're learning somebody, you have a new partner, and you got tested, and you got and did all these things. Because remember, we're talking
safety
about
first.
Safety first. We're talking about things that are going to be done in a monogamous relationship or with your partner that you are
your
in a
special
committed.
Person.
Yes.
As they said, statement for your wife. So this is your special person we're talking about. Not just any and anybody.
Yeah. So these kinds of things, which is how come Amazon was hot, because all these women was over here in quarantine and had their asses out here working overtime about these damn toys. The struggle is real. Okay, if you don't have no partner, you better know how to partner yourself. If you don't have no partner, you better prepare for when you
have
a partner
one, right.
So that you can show this person what you want
or
and how
the
you
partnership
want.
Partnership is not going to last very long.
No. So this is what their sex therapists, their sex educators in their villages are saying, right? Touch yourself, ladies. Change your diet. Some foods are aphrodisiacs. They're not saying to change your diet. You don't have to be a vegetarian to have good sex. It's not saying that. You don't have to be, you know, a meat eater to think that, you know, you can be stronger to have more girth. I don't know. I'm just saying. They're talking about change your diet as far as having some foods that are aphrodisiacs inside. Which is about what I'm talking about, right? With those boss bites.
Mm-hmm.
Boss love bites. Black Orchid Sensual Secrets, what it is having there. Shatavaria, that helps with the lubrication. That's an adaptogen that helps you to keep your stressors down and to keep your turned up. It has maca root. It's good for virility, right?
Right.
It's good for stamina. It's an also an adaptogen that's good for sexual virility. And also has ashwagandha inside there. These are the three things that I've been using inside of the Boss Love Bites that are aphrodisiacs, and they're also good for sexual arousal in both men and women. These things can be eaten, they're raw. Plug, plug, plug. Let me chime. Change your diet. So eat foods like bananas, peanut butter, honey, contain vitamin B, which helps you to give your libido a natural boost. It says, You see there?
I'm about to run over that.
Celery can also help you get going. It also contains aldosterone, a hormone said to aid in female desire. So juice you some vegetable juices, your green drinks with a lot of celery. Not even a lot, but just put enough in there because it's pungent. You know what I'm saying? Balance it out. I'm sure you can do it. Make a nice vegetable drink with that, with some kale and stuff. You can even put like a... what do you call that? Pineapple juice, to make it like a green machine.
Right.
Right? There are a number of other natural libido boosting foods that can also awaken desire. So they're talking about number five. So number one was what? Accept yourself. Number two, we're talking about thinking about pleasure, setting the mood. We're talking about burning incense. We're talking about chudrai. We're talking about things that are inside the O2 Sensual Sanctuary, right? We're talking about touching yourself. I have some toys coming. You'll see those on the website soon. They're coming. They're en route. I ordered some massagers and some dildos just the other night. Because why? That's what we have in the sanctuary. It's been taking a long time for me to find a distributor, which is how come I haven't done it sooner. But you could ask Oshun. This was part of the stuff before the COVID had happened. And now, you know, it's my dolls right now. It's all sold out. I got the last five. I'm just playing. So then we got touch yourself, change your diet, pamper yourself is the next one. How about treating yourself to a long, warm bubble bath, what we were talking about in the sanctuary. Set your mood. All of those things. Oshun, she got some very, very nice honey scrub. The Oshun honey scrub, citrus scrub.
The citrus scrub.
We got some nice products for that. Fill up your bubble bath, light your candle. Put your aromatherapy going on. Wear your sexy to feel sexy. What do we call that one, Oshun?
Hey.
Wear your sexy to feel sexy.
Ooh, your lingerie.
Yes.
Your becho.
Your becho.
Your waif beads.
Your crotchless panties.
Your crotchless panties.
On date night. Or your crotchless panties just because... so it go. You just want to.
Right.
You can adorn yourself. You don't have to have a partner to feel good and to feel sexy and to romp around in of them whenever you feel like.
Yes, ma'am.
Right? We have to practice.
Just stand up in that mirror.
Yes. Not a what? Your own personal photo shoot. Right? So, wear sexy to feel sexy. We know what that means. We have those for you here in the sanctuary. Oshun, she's going to bust her line. When is your line coming out?
The 31st.
The 31st. Be on the lookout for that special, you know, invite to come and check out the goods online. Mm-hmm. Bust out. Yes. Relax yourself. Do whatever you need to take your mind off of the worries and relax your mind. Because why? If your mind ain't right, your sex ain't going to be right either. How can you get lubricated? How can you feel relaxed and in the mood? How can you even loosen up your hips to open up your legs to take any kind of something going on inside that area there? If you're just tight and rigid up so because you're just so stressed and worried. No. Find what it is. Invest in your massage therapist. Get some massagers. You know, they have those things that you can put. I have them too. I have them. TENS unit, trans-electro neural stimulators. They use them in physical therapy. You have sore muscles or aches and pains. They have
these little patches that you stick on.
Yes, okay. Those are those patches that you stick on. You can use them as far as like a massage goes, or you can use them also in ways for acupuncture, because some of them come along with diagrams on where to place them.
Or if you have a partner.
Exactly.
That is the foreplay. Like,
yes.
Come on, give me a massage.
Yes.
Let's go.
Nice sensual oil with some lang, some kind of nice sexiness inside there. Tone up.
Aromatherapy oil.
You know?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All of those things.
That's setting the mood for both of you.
It all starts with foreplay between a man and wife. You touch and caress each other. It's an exchange. The woman must feel relaxed. Just Ashe. What she said.
Hey.
Non-sexual intimacy. How much times brother don't know about that? God, no. I don't think they know about
they
that.
Don't.
They don't know that.
That's why we need to give them this book.
Everybody, the next time you want to give your partner a gift,
yes,
do yourself a favor and give him this one.
Yeah, it's a must. It's a must. We need to reprogram our minds of what we deserve in the bedroom, and they need to reprogram their minds of how to give.
Yes, a couple that reads this book together has better sex together.
Yes.
I don't think you can have it, you know. Well, again, Ms. Rwanda, you know, she had an entanglement. I don't really understand the circumstances. I don't know how long he was gone far, you know, risking his life in the war. I'm just saying, entanglements is not supposed to be happening with this book according to the practices of this book.
Right.
You're supposed to be having good things all the time and be smiling all the time, that there's no room for entanglements.
Happy balance.
Yes.
Everything in at the right place. Yes.
Non-sexual intimacy, right? Holding hands, talking to each other, communication. If you can't communication, that's very sexy, just to be able to communicate with your partner and he openly receives what you are saying and openly gives you back some kind of positive feedback. Mm-hmm. It doesn't always have to be positive, but just the reasoning alone.
Right.
I've been in relationships where the reasoning was just non-existent. Non-existent, and I always just had to just reason in myself and like, boy, oh boy, and just sort
and
it out differently.
I bet he expected you to go to bed and stay wide. Right?
Yes.
Because that's the expectation in the Western world.
Give me some.
Give me some. You're my partner. This is mine. I mean,
may I have the title.
Right.
Boy. Them things can work.
When there's other layers to and dimensions to a woman, it's not just physical with us.
And that's why entanglements happen.
Right.
Because why? He wasn't getting the smile, the feel good that you needed. He might have the most powerful everything and everything, but you ain't smiling at the end of the day. You ain't getting that feel good.
We're not talking.
We're not talking.
There's no communication there.
Yeah.
I mean, if I can't communicate with you in the real world about little things, how am I supposed to communicate with you in the bedroom about what I want?
Yes.
Are you going to block that or are you going to receive it?
Well,
Kanye said,
well, yeah.
And am I going to be comfortable to come to you to tell you what I want?
No, you're not. And so it's going to be messed up, and so the sex is going to be turned off, and then maybe you just stop having, and you stop having a turn on, you stop having sex, and then sex is non-existent. Exactly. And they was talking about when your relationship has non-existent sex, then you just don't even have a marriage. Right. When you're not having these kinds of, when you're not having sex, you're really not having a marriage, according to Rwandan
cultures, yeah,
because it's so intertwined and in having
Indian culture, yeah,
great sex and great sensual sex and great intimacies, that if you're not having it, it's just
an intimacy,
it's nothing.
Intimacy is just not, it's not just sex, it's the whole act of being, the sensuality, how you treat yourself first of all, and then how you want your partner to treat you.
Yeah,
so you have to touch yourself, you have to dress up for yourself, you have to explore yourself, you have to get yourself ready for your partner. And then your partner has to do the same for you.
Yeah. That's what they're talking about basically in part 8, in number 8 for the non-sexual intimacy, is mostly talking about the communications, the non-verbal communications as well.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? It doesn't always have to be about penetration and rub up and stuff like that. You can cuddle, you can hold hands. It could be you doing something, working side by side on a project, sharing an interest. You know what I mean? He has his thing, I have my thing together, we have our thing together. Kind of things,
right.
You know? Right. Outside of the bed. Number 9 is talking about remind yourself. Take time to remind yourself of passionate encounters you've had. So that's like reminiscing on when you had that one back shot and it was just like mind blower. And you was like, God damn. How long we don't have no good loving? That's what they're talking about. Reminisce on when the times was good and when the time was hot. Because those kind of things spark the feelings again, right? And then those things kind of lead to you reading erotica. This is kind of like an erotica book, right? It's a cultural book.
Yeah.
And then they're talking about having erotica books also to read. Erotica is known to arouse women. It's even sexier when you read romantic love scenes thinking about your lover. So these kinds of things are gonna make you masturbate, is gonna make you wear some sexy shit, is gonna make you be in a good mood. Just any of these kinds of 10 things are great starters on self-care, on self-love, and reclaiming your sensuality and your sexuality that's been kicked under the rug and kicked under, you know, this notion that we can't be pleasured, and that
the Western ideology of
a sensual woman, or to feel sensual,
keeping it under wraps for society,
is not a taboo.
And
it's a real thing
around it.
It's a birthright.
Yeah,
is what these women were saying inside of this book. So there's a lot more to be going on with this book, but these are just some of the things, some of the points,
the highlights
that came across me. The introduction is amazing. Again, this is by Brother Habeeb Akande. He's I believe he's in the UK. He has a couple of other books that we're going to be reading. The Taste of Honey is the next book after this. But there's also a documentary. They said that the documentary came out. You saw it already?
Yeah.
I need to see it. We should send a link. Is it something that's on like a YouTube link, or is it?
It should be now. It should
okay.
be now.
Yeah. It's called The Sacred. I think it's called The Sacred Water.
Yeah, The Sacred Water. Yeah, I've seen it.
Yes. So that could be a really good reference as to what they're talking about. And there's even like other versions of these kinds of writings in non-African, where was it? In European countries, I think there was a German version. There's all kinds of versions of these kinds of African spiritual practices that these people, like I said, are coming over and taking and using and putting it inside their literature. And I'm so glad that this brother came forefront and sharing it with us now, because this is for us women. This is for us to empower us
and men.
As women and men to keep, you know, our unions that much tighter, right? It's very rare that you see couples, for me, nowadays. I can't even think about how many people that I know personally from where I came up that have partners like in a well, equally balanced relationship. And they're talking about these things And what that means is not just about sex, it's about being a provider and what that honor means to be able to provide your woman this kind of service, to provide your children mm-hmm. everything that they need, to provide your woman everything that she needs so that she doesn't have to want for anything. I don't know those kinds of relationships.
Right.
I don't. You know, and that's really sad, but you know, I'm open to learning and receiving all of these teachings and practices, and that's what I'm saying. For the partner, the next partner that I'm gonna have in my life is gonna have to know these kinds of things, because this is a special tradition that we need to encourage and facilitate in these times right now.
I think we need to start talking to our daughters too, right?
Yeah.
And talking to our sons about these things too.
Yeah, it has to.
They can't just learn from school sex education and from porn. Like, they can't do that anymore. We have to retrain them to understand what it is to be their sexuality, their sensuality, and how to own that and to stand in that and say, yes, this is me.
Mm-hmm.
And then to take that on, that same vibes, and vibrate with a partner who's on the same frequency.
It's true. It's true. Just like what they're talking about. And I've met men that are really talking about their seed and how sacred their seed is. So brothers, your seed is very sacred. And just like, you know, we are sacred women and our wombs are just as sacred as y'all seed. You know what I mean? So we're learning about things so that we can preserve ourselves, keep everything, intact. Whether it's through internal, external, physical, mental.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? We need those kinds of balances in our lives. So with that, Kunyaza, we're going to read the next 4-6. Let's read chapter 4 or 5.
Right.
Four and five.
To be honest, I was struggling.
Let's read chapter 4 or 5. There's a lot to do in the daytime.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Especially if your schedule is hectic. And it's not a hard read. But, you know, just to have that kind of space and time. To just
indulge into it.
Yes.
Like, between the kids, work, and then my businesses, it was kind of hard for me to sit down and actually find time to indulge in it.
Yes.
So I think we should read the next 2 chapters. So that's chapter 4 and 5.
Yes, let's read chapter 4 and 5.
Chapter 4 and 5, and then we'll talk about those 2 chapters next Wednesday.
Yeah, that'll be good. Let me turn up the music a little bit, because we're about to turn up a little bit. Discussion off. I'm just playing.
Nikani's about to feed me.
Hey! Yeah. The same, so we do it. All right, so here we are. Thanks for everybody that's been tuning in. I know we had a late start or whatever, but we bringing you the business tonight. We got some new dealios for realio. I got the dildos coming. I ain't playing. I'm gonna show you on the live. I'm gonna show you how they work. I ain't gonna use them, but I'm gonna show you how they work. But guess what? Tonight is a very special night. I asked my sister in here, Shuni. She has this nice, pretty mannequin here. Let's see if we can turn off a little bit of lights and see if it turn up the little button right there. You see it right there? Let's see if it's going to turn up. Yeah, turn that one. Press the one there and make it. Turn that one off and make it. Let's see. All right. Oh, you can't see it. But my beads here, you can't see them.
Yeah.
There we go. There we go. Oh, put on the little lamp then. Put on the little lamp back again. All right, so this right here, this is a nice shot. Let's see if we can screenshot that one there. Let me see. No, it won't do it. Anyway, so this right here, what you're seeing right now is a Black Orchid Sensual Secret Becho. A becho, in essence, is an African-style lingerie. It has lace, it has panels. Can you hold the camera for me, Shirley? It has lace. Go back a little bit. Yeah. It has lace in these panels where they open up on the side. So imagine where your legs are going to be going through the sides here. you adorn yourself with your waist beads. In this case, these ones glow in the dark, right? These ones glow in the dark. Maybe the light is not so bad that you can't see it so well, but it does glow in the dark. Maybe it's too bright inside here. But basically, these are the kind of things in African culture, like in Senegal, what is called a becho.
Thank you.
So a becho, these are my new line of becho is going to be coming out. Yeah, I'll bring it back up again. You can see it in the day. There we go. Yeah, so this is the becho. These are the material. And you wear your base beads here on the side. You adorn yourself. You can, I put them on the outside, but you can wear them on the inside. And again, you're going to be burning your churai. You wear your nice little bra in your room, in your sensual sanctuary that you create. Because remember, women, we are sensual sanctuaries ourselves. So we want you to represent that in your room, in your bedroom. So this is one of our first products in the becho category, and we're gonna have some live models as well. I don't know if I can turn her around. Yeah, you can turn it around, huh? So this is the back side. So you can see where the see-through part is. That's where your butt is. Your ass cheeks, your body is gonna be hanging out right there. If you have on a thong, it's nice and pretty. If you have on a crotchless panty from O2 Sensual Sanctuaries to complement with a nice hot pink something. You know what I'm saying? And again, you can get some nice custom waist beads over here made by Sister Amber Honey. She got all the custom bin bins. If you want to adore, Shuni got it going on. You know what I'm saying? So yes, this is called a becho. And my girlfriend, Aluna Funkwear, you know what I'm saying? She's the queen of selling Africa funky prints and stuff. She also has a big shipment of bechos coming out in the next couple of weeks. She got 60 pounds of African stuff going on. I just want to big her up because guess what? She got me some churai. I said, sis, I need some churai. I got this business I'm popping off with and I can't get to none. I'm not in Africa. Can you send me some? So that's where my churai came from. Big up yourself, Sister Luna Funkwear. Big up yourself. Give thanks for getting me set up with my business, sis. That's how we do. You know what I'm saying? She's been doing a lot of this African stuff for many, many years. I'm in the African dance community. We do the same things but different. We have a sensual sanctuary. I use some of the products that she sells. You know what I'm saying? Same but different.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? There's enough for everybody. Big up yourself straight, my sis. Love you every time. We go back way, way back. That's just the day when I first started dancing. Anyway, that's another story. But basically, you can also wear bechos over as a slip. So a becho is like a slip underneath your African attire. So you have your nice frock, and then you have what's considered your lingerie. This is like a lace panty. You know what I mean? What you wear underneath. You don't wear these outside, outdoor robes, right? This is not the kind that you want to wear to the beach.
But you are your man.
This is some special sanctuary stuff that you want nice in your nice little cubby with your nice little sachets. We talked about these in the last meeting with your nice little panty drawer sachets that's dedicated to all your sensual sanctuary goodies. You see it? Goodie! So yes, so this is the becho. And I wanted to also talk to you about our giveaway. Are we having a giveaway?
Yeah, we're having a giveaway.
Okay. So tell them about the giveaway, sis.
So, well, it's going to be posted. I think I'm going to post it. What's today? Wednesday?
Today is Wednesday.
I'm going to post the giveaway on Friday of the criteria. But we'll show you what you're going to get in the giveaway.
Yes, yes, yes.
I'm going to show you what you're going to get in the giveaway. I haven't come up with a lot of the terms yet, so I'm still pending on it, but the Connie is going to show you what we're going to give you.
Yes, Pandora trip, man. We're supposed to be having some nice, nice
so
music going
on
right now. Right now, right now, okay. Right now, we have started off with the incense, right? We got the nice kofel for you when you rise in the mornings and you open up your gates and open up your windows. If you have your AC on all night, you definitely want to open up your doors and open up your windows first in the morning and burn some of the kofel for setting the energies, dispelling the bad stuff for the day, you know what I'm saying? Or you can also burn this one here, these little gray ones. These are little churai resins, what's called shaitan. Shaitan is supposed to be to burn out shaitan, to burn out the negative energy. So this one we call burn out bad mind. So you have one copal incense, which is the Ethiopian style incense that you might find in like the churches, right? Along with like the frankincense and myrrh, kind of like, It's very, very nice. I love it. I always burn it. I burn them all the time. I ain't gonna lie. I burn this one. I burn all of these. I burn these in the morning, mostly when I'm cooking Ethiopian food or in the mornings when I open my door. I burn one of these first. The burn out the shaitan. I do the copal. And then sometimes I burn the little Bali one right here, which is the one that I'm offering. It's like a little black tree bark rolled in essences and resins of nice smelling aromas. And that one is also good for the sensual secrets, the sensuality part of the aromas, right? The gongo. Gongo is called. So, and this one is also a sachet. So you're getting a sachet that you can also use each of these as an incense for the sensual sanctuary. You also have the bad mind burn out the bad mind incense, and you have the copal resin.
So they're gonna get three incense.
Yep.
Three little sachets of incense you're gonna get. This one you can also use in your drawer with your panties.
Yes, it has a little cowrie shell inside.
What else are we giving them?
Bam! Hey! We're giving you one bling, 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 bling. We're giving you one of these nice, hotted up, caliente. Here we go. We're giving you one of these nice little jobs right here. It's a crotchless set, stretchy. One size fits most, right? It stretches. We've seen them. So don't think that you have to be the skinny mini on the fit right here to fit it here. It's nice and hot and red, chilly.
It's calentera.
You know what I'm saying? Caliente, easy access. You know what I'm saying? But when you want to practice how to love yourself, you have to put on that "want to love myself" clothes, right? What else we got for them, Shuni?
So I don't have it here, but I'm also gonna include a scrub, and you're also gonna get a custom waist bead made by me. So you get a piece of lingerie, three sachets of incense
for the sanctuary.
You get a scrub and you get a custom waist bead. And the
Then you get a tear off.
And you get a tear
easy
off.
Easy access. Hey. Open up.
Yala.
Go there.
So the I'm looking at the time, so we're up 1 minute and 32 seconds.
Okay.
So the giveaway will be posted on Friday.
Alright. Before the time run out, I also wanted to introduce that myself, Nikani Shawishi, the Black Orchid, is teaming up with the Tamarack Fitness Center, and I'm going to be doing the pop-up African dance class this Sunday, okay? The address is 7935 West McNabb Road, right? For all of you that's interested, hit me up in the DM, hit us up at O2 Sensual Sanctuary, hit us up at Black Orchid Sensual Secrets.
And AmberHoney_UT for I Am AmberHoney or AmberHoney Accessory.
The class is going to be $15. We're going to have live drummers, you know what I'm saying? And the capacity is up to 25 people per COVID guidelines. It's a really big open up space. And the video is almost done. So if you want any information, just send us a DM. Nikani Shawishi, Black Orchid Sensual Secrets.
And Shuni, I am AmberHoney.
And we are O2 Sensual Sanctuary.
Good night, guys.
Good night.
Love, love, and blessings.
Okay. You can put the